Hello and good evening. This is the Digital Age. I'm Jim Zirin. Tonight we have a great show for you about China. Almost 4 years ago, Hu Jintao was elected president of China, and he promised a harmonious society. Today, despite unprecedented economic growth, China's society is hardly harmonious, beset by political unrest, demonstrations, pollution of water and air, and throttling dissident expression on the internet. China is truly at a crossroad. Which brings us to our question tonight. Is the closed net China's Achilles heel? And here to discuss it with us is someone who knows more about China than almost anyone. She is Elizabeth Economy, who is the CV Star Fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations and author of a prize-winning book, The River Runs Black, The Environmental Challenge to China's Future. Liz Economy, welcome.
Thanks very much, Jim.
Now, no one can deny that China is on the verge of an economic miracle, but how has this affected other aspects of their society, notably environmental issues?
Well, over the past 25 years, you're absolutely right, there's no doubt that China has grown at unprecedented rates, averaging 10 to 12% every year. But what this has done, quite frankly, is to cause a dramatic impact on the environment, a dramatic negative impact on the environment, as well as a range of other social issues. Because when the Chinese government decided to loosen the restraints on the economy, they also dismantled the entire social welfare system. So we see in education, public health, and the environment that they failed to put into place a system of protecting these public goods, of providing these public goods for the Chinese people. So across the full spectrum of social issues right now, China's really facing a crisis.
Your book argues that they're in crisis basically because of their political system, does it not? That you have 23 autonomous provincial governments and you have municipalities with their own governments.
Right. I think that to understand where China is today in terms of the environment, first of all, you need to know that across the full range of issues, whether we're talking air pollution, water scarcity, land degradation, China tops the world charts. So China has 5 of the world's 10 most polluted cities. It's about 70% of the water that runs through its major rivers is polluted. And about a quarter of China, and China is roughly the same size as the United States, about a quarter of the country is technically classified as desert. And the desert is expanding at a rate of about 1,900 square miles per year. So again, across the full range of sort of environmental issues, China faces a real crisis. The roots of this crisis are, on the one hand, that kind of unfettered go-go economic growth with absolutely no environmental protection to go alongside it. But at the same time, as you suggest, China's political system. Because the Chinese leadership made the decision to decentralize authority down to local officials. Basically, environmental protection rests in the hands of local officials. And local officials are, by and large, corrupt. and they have as their basic mandate to grow the economy. They're not that interested in protecting the environment. So both in terms of the political system and the economic system, neither one of these things really is working to advance the cause of environmental protection.
Now, they have a set of economic laws and regulations, don't they? I mean, they got them from us.
Right. They have.
Do they not enforce them?
Yes, they have. You know, on the books, China's environmental laws and regulations are, I'd say 80% of them are probably as good as those that we have in the United States or in Japan or in Europe. But the problem really does boil down to enforcement. So you have a weak governmental apparatus on the one hand and at the local level. And at the same time, China hasn't yet proved willing to put the investment into the legal infrastructure. So you have very poor legal enforcement at the local level. And the kinds of tools that we have in the West, right, for ensuring that our officials do what they're supposed to do, namely non-governmental organizations, environmental activists, the media, a free and open media, the internet, all of these things are constrained by the central government in Beijing. They exist in China, certainly, but they're constrained because the government is afraid of loosening the reins of power too much, loosening their political control too much, so that in somehow this kind of thing might transform into an overall push for broader reform in the country.
Well, the central government's investment in environmental protection is only about 2.5% of GDP, isn't that right?
Oh, it's not even close to that.
Not even close
it's actually,
to that.
Yeah, it's actually about 1.3, moving up to about 1.5% of GDP. So it falls someplace in the middle of all developing countries. But given where China is today economically, it should certainly be investing far more. And you know, you might have been thinking of, you know, 2.5% is the number that some Chinese scientists have suggested is the minimum that the government should be investing in order to keep the situation from deteriorating
so
further.
So they're even well below the minimum that scientists suggest.
Absolutely.
What is the source of the pollution? I know that coal represents 66% of their energy supply.
Yeah, China is the largest consumer of coal in the world, and it's planning to double its coal consumption between 2000 and 2020. Right now, even as it talks about addressing the issue of global climate change, addressing its own air quality, getting ready for the Olympics, especially in Beijing, it's building one new coal-fired power plant per week in the country. So it really is a coal-based economy. And in terms of its air quality, of course, this has had a very significant impact. 400,000 people in China are estimated to die prematurely every year because of respiratory diseases related to air pollution. So coal, in terms of the air quality, has everything to do with it, as does the growing use of cars in China. Here, China actually has, coming up to 2008-2010, tougher fuel efficiency and auto emission standards than we have in the United States. Unfortunately, the quality of the fuel is so low that it continues to make the transportation sector an important contributor to air pollution.
Now, there's also been political unrest. I think there were 87,000 demonstrations last year. I mean, do these arise out of protests against the lack of environmental protection?
Absolutely. The Chinese government has said that in May, they published this statistic that there were 50,000 environmental protests in 2005. And, you know, just to give you a sense, we're not really talking about two or three people walking down the street, you know, with a placard that says, please clean up our air. You know, in some cases, we're talking about 30 or 40,000 villagers demonstrating against, you know, a number of polluting chemical factories in Zhejiang province, for example, in a protest that turned quite violent. People were killed. And this is a situation where the villagers had tried to get redress for the fact they knew that these chemical factories were polluting their water, polluting their crops, making their children sick. And for 2 years, they tried to get local officials and provincial officials to act, but they couldn't. So they essentially took to the streets. Or we could be talking about 100,000 people in Sichuan province protesting a dam that was being built. And again, the protests turned violent. They had to send in upwards of 30,000 people's armed police to contain these protests. So these are not insignificant demonstrations in most cases that the Chinese government is having to contend with.
And then you also have these horrific coal mining accidents with 85, 100, 150 miners killed at a time. Yeah. And these have given rise to demonstrations, have they not?
That's also true. In fact, China has the worst record in the world in terms of coal mining safety. I think some 6,000 coal miners died in coal mine accidents last year. And, you know, quite frankly, I think as we look toward the future, one of the things that we have to be concerned about is that Chinese mining companies increasingly are going abroad. Into Latin America, Southeast Asia, and Africa. And we have to think about, you know, whether or not they're really exporting some of their worst practices. And whether we're talking about the environment or labor safety, the fact that China is this growing global economic giant and beginning to, you know, it's multinationals are themselves going abroad, the impact that they're going to have throughout the world, I think, is something that we're going to have to watch very carefully.
So China's become, in effect, a multinational, going to Africa looking for energy in Angola and other parts of Africa.
That's right. They're becoming a very significant player in Africa. They already have been one for a while in Southeast Asia, and we see them increasingly in Latin America. And, you know, in search of all sorts of natural resources, you know, oil and gas, as you point out, a range of metals, copper, iron ore, and timber. So, again, China's practices, the way that it does business environmentally, is going to be very important, you know, going toward the future.
Now, let's move on to the situation with the internet in China. It's well known that it has a closed internet. The government exercises surveillance. It has as many as 30,000 internet police who watch what's going on the internet. Is this an aspect of how the harmonious society has failed?
Well, I think when Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao talked about the harmonious society, they probably view internet control as a very important element of achieving that harmonious society.
Perhaps uniform, but possibly not harmonious.
Right. I think the Chinese government has been probably more successful in some respects than anybody had predicted in terms of actually being able to control access to websites and, if not control the content of information at any given point in time, certainly being aware enough of what's being posted that, you know, within a day or two of something that they don't like being posted, they can shut it down. They have the internet police. They block over 20,000 websites in any case. So unless you're in China and have access to a server overseas, you really find it very difficult to get access to many websites. And you know, there are a number of key search words that they sort of filter for.
Taiwan, Tiananmen.
Exactly. So you
democracy.
Know, right. And if you look on Tiananmen with hopes of finding out something about the Tiananmen Square demonstrations and the democracy movement of 1989, what you're going to get are tourists, you know, visiting Tiananmen Square in Beijing.
Or directions to the Great Hall of the People.
Exactly.
Now, you have American internet companies that are active players in China, Microsoft, Yahoo, Google. Haven't they been complicit in this censorship? For example, Microsoft has something called MSN Spaces. That's how I would put a blog on the internet. Microsoft is cooperating with the, said they're cooperating with the Chinese government, are they not?
Well, I think that in particular, Microsoft and Google, perhaps somewhat less so Yahoo, have agonized extensively and quite publicly over their doing business in China. And I think, you know, quite frankly, as many companies did in the aftermath of Tiananmen, they sort of weigh, you know, the sort of two sides of the coin, right? One, they can not do business there and sort of make their protest known that way, or they can continue to do business and think that they're pushing the edge of the envelope. And whatever kind of greater access they can provide to the Chinese, they're doing sort of the purpose of transparency and openness a greater service. And I think this is where they're coming down right now. But certainly we saw where one of the head of government relations for Microsoft recently said in Athens, that you know, Microsoft is constantly thinking, continually evaluating the role that they're playing in China and anywhere else they're doing business for precisely that kind of issue.
Now, there's a blogger named Michael Anti.
Yes.
Perhaps that's his nom de guerre, but
right.
Michael Anti had a blog, and
right.
Microsoft agreed to remove him, to shut it down.
That's right. And Michael Anti had been very active, had been talking a lot about democracy issues, and but when he sort of moved into the issue of organizing on behalf of democracy, that's when the Chinese government stepped in, and Microsoft agreed, that's right, to shut down his blog. And but, you know, the Chinese government was well aware of his activities. You know, unlike the case of Yahoo, Microsoft didn't actually turn over information to the Chinese government. So if you want to sort of draw a fine distinction there, I think there is one to be drawn.
Now, Google is losing market share to a Chinese search engine called Baidu.com.
That's
right.
Are
you familiar with that?
I am familiar with that, and Baidu has been very successful in China. They're on the march to move into Japan right now. Baidu benefits, I think, not so much from being a more sophisticated or better version of Google, or even more in tune with Chinese interests and needs, because I don't think that it is. Baidu benefits from good relations with the Chinese government. In the past, it has been suggested, I think probably quite rightly, that the Chinese government has acted to slow Google's service, thereby making Chinese users go over to Baidu and use their service. And there also exists within China a certain degree of nationalism and of nationalistic pride. And
so there's a campaign, don't patronize the foreign website,
Absolutely.
Google, come
That's
to Baidu.
Right. That's
Baidu
right.
is owned by the government?
No, it's there's a, you know, it's Chinese private company, you know. So it's, no, it's a privately owned company, which actually may even have gone public. I'm not quite sure, but it definitely started off as a private venture by someone who was trained in the United States, Chinese who was trained in the United States.
But if I were a Chinese in Beijing, I couldn't find Michael Antai's website on Baidu.
Absolutely not. No, and Baidu has very explicitly, has very much made it clear that it is not interested in doing anything that would cross the Chinese government, that in fact they work hand in hand with the Chinese government.
But the American internet companies keep coming. I read recently that MySpace, which is was acquired about a year ago by Rupert Murdoch, which is kind of a social interaction internet site, was entering China, and Rupert Murdoch's wife, Wendy Dong, is on the board of MySpace China. The Chinese government is eyeing that warily, because I don't think they really like the idea of people having getting together and having interactions on the internet. But so what do you make of all that?
Well, again, I think that you know, every multinational has to make the decision about what kind of role they want to play in China, and sort of you know, can they be a force for change, or, you know, can they make money? I mean, these are the kinds of considerations that, that any company will make. I think in terms of MySpace, I think the Chinese government, frankly, is wary of anything they haven't seen before. And my guess is that within a year, or maybe even less time, you'll see a Chinese version of MySpace try to capture that market even before perhaps MySpace can get in and make its stake its claim. So I don't know that it's as much about Chinese. I mean, the Chinese might be nervous up front, but I think the minute that a Chinese company makes its bid, you'll see MySpace kinds of activities developing very rapidly in the country.
Now, this month, Secretary of the Treasury Hank Paulson, who was certainly an old China hand when he was head of Goldman Sachs, he had many business relationships in China, he knows who all the players are, is going to lead a delegation, a phalanx, if you will, of top officials for talks with the Chinese government. And while he stresses monetary policy, he's bringing trade officials, environmental officials, all cabinet-level people. What do you think the Paulson mission is likely to accomplish?
You know, to be blunt, I think the answer is probably not much. I think the truth is that, you know, this is all under the rubric of a strategic dialogue with China. And I think when Deputy Secretary of State Bob Zelik initiated the dialogue over a year ago now, I think everybody thought it was a great idea, because we need to have this kind of overarching vision, this kind of working together over the long term with the Chinese. But I think what's transpired, quite frankly, is the Chinese are more than happy to have a strategic dialogue, because a strategic dialogue, again, implies over the long term. What we really want to see here are some actual short-term successes, right? So we want to see progress on the Chinese currency, right? Progress.
What's the issue there? Maybe.
You know, we want the Chinese currency eventually to move toward a free float. We want to see it appreciate in value so that Chinese exports become more expensive and our own domestic production therefore becomes more competitive.
And the government is holding it artificially low.
Absolutely. And so the Chinese government is. Now, the truth is that when you look at a trade deficit now between the U.S. and China that's, you know, going to be over $200 billion, right?
$200 billion.
Yes, $200 billion. You know, the estimates of what, say, a 20% revaluation of the yuan will do, maybe $10 billion or maybe $20 billion. So in some respects...
Every little bit helps.
That's true. That's true. But in some respects, the issue is a little bit of an artificial one. I mean, because again, what we really want to see, I think, is some systemic change on issues like intellectual property rights protection, which where the impact could easily be $30 to $40 billion difference in terms of the trade deficit if China would just protect our U.S. intellectual property. We want to see market access improvements. You know, right now we're taking an action, and USTR Schwab, Susan Schwab is going as part of this delegation. We have an action that we're taking before the WTO adjudication along with the Canadians.
WTO is the World Trade Organization.
Right, and have an action that we're taking on auto parts. Because we can't, they put impose such a heavy duty on our auto parts that they make them non-competitive in China. So, and this is in violation of China's WTO accession agreement. And there are a whole range of areas, frankly, where China is in violation of its WTO accession agreement. So I think these are the kinds of changes. We need systemic change in China on the economy. Currency is one aspect of that, but it's really only one.
Well, if the dollar strengthens, it will make it more attractive for Americans, American goods to be purchased in China, which is good for our trade deficit, and it will be also incentivize Americans to buy more U.S.-made goods because the cost of Chinese goods here will rise.
Right.
And all that is certainly to be desired. But are there other systemic changes that could be made that would have the result of reducing our current accounts deficit and our trade deficit with China?
Well, I think, again, as far as the relationship with China is concerned, I think the three issues really are the currency, market access, and intellectual property rights protection. You know, to be frank, we probably need to do more on our own side. Right, and we probably need to save more here in the United States and spend a little bit less.
Right.
I mean, I think that there are some domestic steps that we need to take.
Consume less gasoline.
Exactly. China is not you know solely responsible for the challenges, and not even probably primarily responsible for the challenges in the U.S. economy. But I think that there's a certain sense that we're not operating on a level playing field here. And we want the Chinese to take action to rectify that situation.
Well, it's particularly interesting that Hank Paulson is taking Stephen Johnson, the head of the Environmental Protection Agency, with him as part of the delegation. I mean, what do you read into his presence?
Right. I think Hank Paulson, you know, is a very smart guy. And I think, again, in the wake of Bob Zelig's departure, Bob was really the sort of strategic guru for China. It left a vacuum. And I think Hank Paulson, to the extent that he can, is trying to fill that vacuum. And so he's really expanded the mandate. I mean, what does Treasury really have to do with the environment, I think is what you're asking.
Yes.
And the question is not much. But I think he's tried to make this, you know, every area that basically touches on the economy, he's put into this dialogue. So you have the environment, you have energy, you have health and human services. So he's bringing everybody, I think, that engages in some aspect of you know, the economy.
But do you see a deal in the making where we'll render assistance to them on the environment if they'll allow the yuan to float within a broader band?
No, I don't see that. I don't think the Chinese are gonna fall for any kind of. We render a lot of environmental assistance and energy assistance. I think one of the fun things that I heard recently, frankly, is that our Department of Energy, has provided all of the technical assistance for the Olympics Village in Beijing to ensure that they achieve the highest energy efficiency standards for these 17,000 Olympic athletes. So there are a lot of cooperative ventures and demonstration projects and things in the works with US EPA and US DOE, et cetera. I think the real challenge, again, though, is if we're looking to have China make changes in the environment in ways that are going to change not only China's own environment, but how China's affecting the rest of the world, like climate change, for example, it's going to require systemic change within China. And that's a much bigger issue then certainly Hank Paulson's delegation is going to be able to deal with.
You've been critical in the past that every time we get together with the Chinese, we talk about trade, we talk about currency, we talk about fiscal matters, and human rights seems to be off the table. What's the human rights position now in China, and what's to be done about it?
I think one of the great, frankly, the great disappointments of this Hu Jintao, Wen Jiabao administration in China over the past 3 to 4 years has been a real regression, I think, in the human rights track record in the country. They have really pulled back, I think, from a lot of the beginnings of openness that we began to see at the end of Jiang Zemin. So now we're seeing, you know, the arrests of, for God's sakes, blind activist lawyers, right, who are defending rural villagers from land grabs. I mean, you know, if you can't get support from Beijing for someone like that, I think that speaks volumes. So I think it's an area that has not dropped off completely in terms of the bilateral dialogue, but I think with our own preoccupation with Iraq, with Iran, North Korea, with trade issues, it really doesn't play the kind of central role in the U.S.-China dialogue that it has in the past. And I think it's a shame.
Arrest of journalists for conducting illegal interviews.
That's right, right.
NGO members.
Not even illegal interviews. You know, legal interviews that basically say something that the Chinese government doesn't want to have publicized.
Right.
You know, then they'll go after those journalists. That's right. They've closed down newspapers in China that have been critical of the government. They've gone after internet journalists, because some journalists have been very aggressive on the internet, not necessarily in print, and they track them down. They've imprisoned them.
For coverage of, for example, the mining disaster.
Exactly, especially for coverage of social unrest or even for local corruption. They have enforced now a rule where journalists can't cover events. Journalists in Beijing can't cover an event in another city outside of Beijing. So they put into place all sorts of limits on freedom of expression, I think, in the country that are very troubling. But in terms of what the United States can do, I think we can push in our bilateral dialogue, we can push in the United Nations, but I don't think that we have all that much leverage in the end.
Is the closed net China's Achilles heel?
I think the closed net will not last, and I think the Chinese government is increasingly going to come to a point where it's going to have to open the door to greater freedoms.
Greater freedoms.
Obsolescence.
Liz Economy, thank you for coming by. That was just terrific.
Thanks very much.
And thank you for coming by. Tune in next week for more on the digital age. For the digital age, I'm Jim Zirin. Good night, and all the best.